today. Let heaven and nature sing. Let his redeemed people shout with the voice of triumph and bless the Lord who endures forever. He's great and greatly to be praised. Amen, amen. Praise God. Well, Merry Christmas to everybody. Why don't you step across an aisle, step across a section if you see somebody you don't know. Introduce yourself. Make them feel at home tonight.
Have a good
good time with your family and friends, and then we will be back together on January the 2nd, which will be a regular Tuesday night. Well, let's worship and give today. And Sister Tashana is going to sing one of my favorite songs. And it talks about what the blood of Jesus does for our life. The Bible talks about, though our sins are scarlet, he makes them white as snow. Amen. That's a real white Christmas right there. I like that. So she's going to sing this for us while we give our offering. Lord, we thank you today for your blessing in our life. We pray that you would bless the gift and the giver alike. I pray that all of those, God, that may be struggling at this time, I pray that blessing would come their way. And Lord, those that are in abundance, I pray that you would continue to bless them so they can be a blessing. Everybody say, in Jesus' name, let's worship and give. Sing, worship with Sister Tashana as she sings. Thank you. With our holiday schedule, we have been unable to give you an update on our most recent trip to the land of Fiji, so we're going to do some of that tonight, but I also want to give you an update on some of the things that we are committed to and giving to on a regular basis. And I'm excited for not only what God is doing locally, but what God is doing from this church and connected with this church around the world. Amen. I'm delighted to be a part of a giving people, a global reaching church. I believe that the Rock Church has been positioned in this end time to be an impactor and a world changer. And we're seeing it. We're seeing opportunities unfold. And so tonight is kind of an end of the year, going to kind of update you on some of the things that are taking place around the world. And before I start with some of the pictures, I want to give you an update. A number of you are here tonight. I look, there's Brother Babineau, there's Brother Jones, there's Sister Tashana Jones. I'm here. I'm trying to think of some of the others that went with us. About 8 or 9 years ago, we went to Honduras to a place called Siguate Peque, which is up in the mountains of the mainland of Honduras. And we were there with Brother Mark and Sister Lori Schreckeis, who have been to this church a couple of times, at least, maybe more than that. And they were planting a brand new work in the place of Siguate Peque. And they were digging it out. They were having church in their home. And through the efforts of many people giving, this church stepped up and not only gave to help them. Every month we support the Schreckeises with monthly support for them as missionaries. But we wanted to do something beyond that. We wanted to get involved personally. So I think it was Brother Ryan, probably, 21, 22 of us, Brother Matt, that went along with Brother P.J. White and Brother Joel Buxton, both pastors. We went down there, and the men and women that from this church helped pour the slab. And if I remember correctly, about halfway through it, we ran out of concrete and had to order some more, and it was a sight to behold. And so we were just in the fly, and we got that done. And we poured. I'm not a concrete guy, but we were out there waiting around, getting concrete smoothed out, and got that sanctuary ground. And then on Sunday, we had the first service on that concrete on the side of that mountain in Siguate Peque. And that church has continued to grow. This church also gave the deposit money for what is now the home of where Brother and Sister Schreckeis live. And it is a beautiful piece of property. And God has added to that church. And that church has continued to grow. And out of that church, there have been, I think, 7 or 8 other churches that have now sprung out of that church under the leadership of Brother Mark and Sister Lori Schreckeis. And today, I got a letter with some pictures from Brother Schreckeis. It was so thrilling to see that the assistant pastor that Brother Jose, that has been working with Brother Sister Schreckeis, God has now lifted him. He is now the pastor of that, I guess we could call it kind of a headquarters church, because the demands of the other churches have grown to the point where now Brother Sister Schreckeis are overseeing a number of other churches. And the man that they have trained up has now taken the position of the pastor of that church, and it is a beautiful growing congregation. I think we ought to thank God for what God has been doing on the mainland of Honduras, and you're invested in that. Amen. Every month, this church is supporting Brother and Sister Schreckeis and that expanded work. And this is a commitment. Let me tell you something. Anybody working in Honduras is committed. See, what you may not know is Honduras is one of the most volatile nations of world history. Since their independence, I believe in 1853, there have been 300 revolutions, civil wars, or uprisings, or coups. 300. That equals out, somebody told me that equals out to be about one every, I think, 9 months. There's an uprising or revolution in Honduras since its inception. And so right now, it's no different. Right now, there's been a huge upheaval in Honduras over the presidential election, and they're rioting in the streets. And so anytime you have missionaries that are committed to continue to preach the gospel You need to uphold them in prayer. You need to stand strong on their behalf. And God, in spite of the confusion and the chaos, His hand of protection and grace and mercy is there, and revival is taking place in Honduras. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise for what He's doing. Amen. So that's a good report on what God is doing in Honduras with the Shrekites family. A few months ago, we were part of a historical night where Brother Franco Platanilla launched the Operation Ministry to go plant a church in Rome. And it is an ongoing process. In fact, right now, the Platanilla family, for those of you that may be new, Brother and Sister Platanilla and their family were a part of this ministry. They're based out of this church and travel. Brother Platanilla grew up in Sicily, Italy, and was saved there. An incredible testimony of how God brought him out of a world of crime and the syndicate and on, and just an amazing testimony of what God has done in his life. And ministry for many years in the United States has been a blessing to so many. Felt a burden to go back and plant an apostolic church in the city of Rome. And so the process was, we were the first church where that was launched. And it's going to be an ongoing thing that I think is going to be very, very important for that part of the world. Rome is a key city of not only history, but presently in that part of the world. And so they are there. And I've got a couple of pictures that Brother Platanilla sent to us. And he is there. And this week, he baptized four people in Italy. And he is there connecting. Amen. He is there connecting with old friends and family that are going to be working with him. This is one of the families that they are connecting with. And we're praying that God continues to open up doors. I think there's another picture. These are some of the folks that they are communicating with and working with. This family has been instrumental in Italy. And so they are there for the last few days, and they will be there for the next few weeks. I'm not sure exactly how long they're there. They're there investigating, looking for facilities, looking for places to rent to hold service, as well as connect with the people. They're assembling a team of people to help them. And here's what's incredible, is that when they set forth the plan to start a church in Rome, God opened up some doors in some other cities. And so it could be, by the time they hit the ground in Italy, there may be two or three church plants or preaching points that open up in other parts of the country, because word got out that Brother Platanilla was coming back to Italy and going to be establishing work. So I want to challenge you. What should you be praying for in 2018 about global reach from this church? You're praying for the Shrekites in Honduras. And you're praying for whatever God is doing in Italy right now. Wouldn't it be incredible for there just to be an earth-shaking revival that explodes out of Rome and just captures that nation with the gospel of Jesus Christ? That's some of your own right there. They're coming out of this church. Yeah. So we're adding that. These are going to be some of the areas of focus that we're going to be praying and talking about and giving you updates in 2018. So I'm really, really excited about what God is doing with the Platanilla family. So stay tuned for further developments. I want us to go back to Honduras, but let's go 26 miles off of the mainland to the little island of Roatan, Honduras. Everybody that's been to Roatan, I want you to stand up. I know we got Hope Corps alumni in here. Amen. Well, we got missionaries back tonight. When'd you get back, baby? Sunday, we'll welcome home. Give her a big hand. We're glad to see her back. You may be seated. So this is just a representation of people that are in this room tonight that have been a part of what God is doing on the island of Roatan. And God is doing some incredible things. I want us to be in prayer. As most of you probably know that follow the Joneses on Instagram, on Saturday night they had one of the biggest events. If you could put that up there, they had one of the biggest events in the history of the church. They had their first Christmas banquet and party, and they had it out at the training center, and they had over 300 people at their Christmas banquet and party. That's awesome. But evidently, word got out that they were gone. And while they were gone, somebody climbed up to their apartment or their house, broke in, and stole everything except the furniture, including their passports, their computers. And in the process, the only way, that's an island, the only way to get out of the country is you have to have your passport or the consulate or the embassy to issue you a new one. But the problem is right now, because of the political unrest with the presidential election, the riots in the street, the embassy is in Tegucigalpa, one of the most dangerous cities in the world. And so to make that transition with your two children, to get flights, you don't have passports to get out of the country. It has been, they go from the biggest event in the history of their church to walk in the door and their house has been totally violated and robbed. Brother Stephen told me, he said, I felt like I went from the height of glory to the depths of despair in just moments. And so I know many of you are praying. I know mom and dad are here and they're praying. But I tell you what, I like old Stephen and Rachel. They just kind of squared their shoulders and he told me, he said, Pastor, all I know is God must be up to something and the devil's going to have to pay a trespass offering. And so when you pray, I want you to pray. How many lift hands and say, I'm going to make some special prayer for the Jones family in Roatan, Honduras. Amen. So God's going to be with them and God's going to help them. But I wanted you to see, these are some important things that are happening, and I think we've got some pictures of the new church is taking strides. This is now, I think since this picture was taken, that second floor or that's the roof, I think, from what I understand. I haven't been there since all this has happened. But this will be a two-story. There will be a church, there will be a coffee shop, and it will be the home where they live right there in that community. And it's going to be an incredible thing. Let me just tell you, I've been in and out of Roatan, Honduras for the last 9 to 10 years. There is not one church, and everybody's been there. When I say this, if you agree, say amen. There is not one church of any brand, title, club, organization, denomination. There's not one that will compare to the beauty and magnificence of this building when it's done. This is going to be a testimony of what God has done. And let me just tell you, it's a big deal. Stephen and Rachel were basically just kids that went over there to help Brother and Sister Malone build the training center. And their plan was to be there for 6 to 8 months and then come home. And you know what happened? Brother Malone had a heart attack in the middle of the building project. And so now here's these two kids from the Rock Church that has to not only become the head missionary, the head pastor, and the head contractor, and he had never been a contractor in his life. And he wound up building the training center, and now my Lord is building the most beautiful church that's going to be on the entire island. That's one of your own Sunday school kids that you put up with. It's family time. This is an awesome thing, what God is doing. I think we ought to clap our hands for what God is doing in Roatan. And we're going to continue to support them on a monthly basis, as well as the projects that are doing. Brother Ryan Babineau, wave your hand over there. Brother Ryan Babineau is going to be instrumental coming up sometime January. Is that right? End of January. Brother Babineau is putting together one of the sealing containers that is going to be loaded with tools and supplies and a whole bunch of different stuff that maybe some of you people could donate. We don't want trash. We want good stuff, okay? So if you're interested in participating, we'll talk more about that. But that's going to be going over from Miami to the island, and they're going to be doing that. So Brother, we thank Brother Babineau for leading that charge, and that will be coming up. So God doing some exciting things in Roatan. And by the way, Brother Stephen talked to me just about 10 minutes before service. I called him to get the latest update. And it looks like the people in charge of the airport, finally, with immigration, they came through and they said, we're going to let you for the holidays. They were leaving to go to Florida for the family reunion of Sister Rachel. And with their passports being stolen, it was very difficult. They weren't going to be able to leave the country. But as of this afternoon, it looks like the head of immigration has given them permission. He said, be at the airport tomorrow, and I will let you get on the plane, and you can go to Miami and get your new passports. there. So Brother Stephen said, I'll breathe a sigh of relief when that plane lands in Miami. So pray for them tomorrow that all that works through it. Are the Joneses here tonight? I'm looking. I know y'all are praying. Amen. Amen. So everything's going to be all right. These are God's kids. And encamped round about them is big, strong angels. Everything's going to be all right. Amen. Amen. Well, we recently returned. I guess it's been about a week and a half since we got back. Brother Wilson and I traveled to the islands of Fiji. And Fiji is one of the most beautiful places on planet Earth. And I don't know why God kind of opens up these opportunities for me, beautiful Roatan and now beautiful Fiji, but I kind of like what he's doing. Pretty cool. I guess we could have, you know, dropped down in Arkansas or somewhere. And I'm glad he's letting us see these other places. But we aren't going there for vacation. We are working. So I want to take you, just to kind of show you, we are working. What God has opened up is in what is called the interior. They call it the highlands of Fiji. We got some Fijians here. They're probably going to start crying when they see these pictures today. They're going to feel like Fijian music needs to come over or something and eat some taro or whatever. Amen. Glad for them. Fiji is about two worlds away from here. It took us 23 hours from San Francisco to get there. We had to fly to Auckland, New Zealand, and we had about a 4.5-5 hour layover, and then we flew back about almost 4 hours back and landed in the islands of Fiji in Nandi. And then after we got to Nandi, we had about a 3 hour drive down a little 2-lane road from Nandi to where we were going to be operating out of in Suva. And Sister Ashley, did those pictures come through? Okay, put up this first one. This is not a postcard. That is my iPhone that has not yet been updated. There's no filter on that. How many are feeling a burden about right now? Now, what's incredible, I'm not at a tourist spot. You want to know where I'm at? I'm standing on the platform of the church in the village of Naivutini. That's taken out the window of the church. How many think you can have church right there? If you go to Lonely Planet and you type in Naivutini and hiking, that is one of the top most rated hikes in the world, right there out of Naivutini. And God has, that river flows right below, and we ate tilapia after service that was speared out of that river the night before. John Mark, you ready to go? You feeling, you getting a burden right now? Amen. This is about an hour out of the city of Suva, which is the capital, which is the biggest city in Fiji. Let's go to the next slide. I just wanted to let you get a little picture of the mountains there. We arrived in our first day after the long and tenuous journey to get there. Got as much sleep as we could. It's a 19-hour time difference, so I'll let you figure that out. And we arrived at the meeting where we would be forming officially the Rock Church of Fiji. And you'll see Brother Jerry Rowley, Brother Doug Walker, myself, and Bishop Wilson. And then to Brother Wilson's left is Brother Levy. That is the general superintendent of the Rock Church of Fiji. The man leaning back looking is Brother Jim. That is the personal best friend of our own brother right here, Brother Bonaparte. And dear, dear friends, this man is a godsend. God has gifted this man for many years. Was the manager of the Novotel Hotel in the city of Mame, just outside of Suva. He has a gift to win souls. He has a gift to teach the gospel, preach the gospel. He was recently in the country of Australia, and miracles. God used him to literally pray for a woman who was very, very, very ill with infection in their body, and he prayed for her. God instantly healed her. And now it looks like a brand new church is going to be started as a result of that man, Brother Jim, and his family. And then just to this side of Brother Jim is Brother Isaiah, who is the pastor in the village of Nyamuthini, which has kind of become ground zero for what God is doing in our Fiji effort. And here's the situation. When we got to Fiji in, I believe it was August, we were there, July or August, I didn't know anybody. I had gone simply on the request of this man of God, that God had spoken to him, and they were reaching out, they had watched some of our services, and wanted me to come teach a seminar on holiness. And we went. I just felt the Holy Ghost speak to me and say to go. And we were there. I taught for the first day for 7 hours. We came back that night for church. Brother Doug Walker preached. We came back the next day. I taught for 6 hours. And then we had church again. And those Fijian men and women sat with pen and paper in their hand. And they never got sleepy. They never got tired. They wanted me to keep going, and I was about to pass out. But when it was over, Brother Levy, the man sitting by Brother Wilson, he began to weep when he introduced me. He said, "Our Father has come." What I didn't know is that for 10 years they had been praying, "God, send someone to teach us. Send someone to teach us." The majority of their churches are in the interior, the mountains of Fiji. And they had been praying, and no one had gone. But I felt the unction of the Holy Ghost to go to Fiji, not knowing any of that. And when I had finished teaching and they had heard our lessons on holiness and separation, they all met with me and they said, "Pastor, we want you to be our leader. We would like to become the Rock Church of Fiji." I said, "Well, why don't you just keep your own name? Why do you feel to do that?" I wasn't imposing this on them. They said, "We feel like God sent you, and that we want to be a part of what God is doing in California, because there's Fijian people in California, and we feel like God sent you not only for them, but sent you for us, and we want you to be our leader." And so it was kind of a weird moment for me. And as I began to find out, there were 16 churches. What God has done is, go to the next slide, Sister Ashley. Since we were there, this was in the meeting. This is where we had to officially and legally, we met with attorneys, we met with the bankers, we had to register, we had to do everything right. And this was at the, we had to hold elections and ratifications. And Brother Walker, myself, and Bishop Wilson, and this was when Brother Levy had just been voted in as the general superintendent of the Rock Church of Fiji, and he is addressing it. From that moment, he led the elections. We now have presbyters, we now have youth leaders, and even ladies auxiliary leaders that are operating there. And those 16 churches, go to the next slide, the word of God has begun to go forth from the teaching and the vigorous growth. And this is the land in the village of Nyamuthini. There is Brother Isaiah, the pastor, Brother Jim, beside Brother Wilson, and then the man holding the umbrella to the left. I don't even know what his name is. He introduced himself as, "I'm the old man of the village." They call him Old Man, so that's Old Man. But Old Man of the village, boy, he knows how to pray. When Old Man prays, I think he touches the Ancient of Days, because stuff starts happening when he prays. But that is the farm. You're at about 2,500 to 3,000 feet in elevation. That is called Taro. In other places, it's called Dalo, D-A-L-O, and Taro, T-A-R-O, which is big in the Asian market in the South Pacific. It's kind of like a potato, I guess would be the closest thing. And it's classy. I see people nodding right there. They know what it is. And it is a growing market even in America. And so this is the first planting. Now let me tell you about this farm. This is a coordinated effort with Bosco International and with the Rock Church of Fiji. And the produce of this farm is going to generate the income to build what will become Wilson University in Fiji. Amen. And what's happened is they approached, they said, "One of the things we would like to do, we know that y'all have, that you," they didn't say y'all, I said y'all. They said, one of the things we understand about the Rock Church is you have training in Bishop Wilson, and we have the college. Could you open a Bible school? So we began to talk about Bible school. How do we do Bible school? Well, we don't have a lot of people in the way to support and build, you know, and send somebody over there. But we began to talk about the internet and with Wilson University, and we began to talk with different leaders that are connected with the education system there. And this is moving forward. And in the process, I met with the pastors in the area, in the interior. And they came up with this plan. This wasn't a Rock Church hatching. This came out of these men. They all gathered and said, Pastor, we'd like to meet with you. We're all farmers. If it's doable, we would like to investigate. Over there, you can't buy land unless it's freehold land, because it's their, what is called indigenous, or the indigenous people, the Fijians, that the land is kind of like land that is reserved for the Native American community. In the interior highlands, you can only get leases. But in order to get a lease, you have to go through the village elders, you have to go through the family elders. And so they said, here's our idea. We would like to establish a farm that the proceeds would build the school and create the opportunity to open up the training center. Went through the process since we were there. They did all of this. They initiated this. The village elders agreed to it. And then I can't remember, is it that what's the word for the family elders? I can't remember the group. You've been gone too long, you don't remember? Mantigali, there it is, Mantigali. So it's got to go through the Mantigali, and the Mantigali signed off on it. They said, we want it. We met with the elders. They met with the elders. And so all of this happened. This land has been deeded on a 99-year lease for Bosco International and the Bible School and the church at the village of Nyalofini. And so that is now our first harvest of the taro. Should be, I think they said, June, July. And in January, cucumbers and watermelons will be planted on this farm. And that will be a 3 and 4 and 5 month harvest that goes along. And there's Bishop Wilson walking through. It was pouring down rain. That was the day after we arrived. I think we were sleepwalking as we went through that. But that harvest is growing. You can see the beauty. I mean, it's just one of the most beautiful places, and this is the site of where the Bible school will be built back toward those hills, and the property continues up, and the long range plan is to see if it's doable. That's the training set or the session with the farm leaders, Brother Doug Walker's addressing. This is the pastor's farm. That's Brother Isaiah on the left, and there's taro planted up those hills there, and this is going to be a pilot program. Here's an amazing thing. I've been doing missions with my parents since I was knee-high to a grasshopper. My dad used to take us. My grandparents were missionaries. Mom was a missionary. My cousins were missionaries. My dad was the missions director for the state of Louisiana for 19 years. So every year, at least one or two of our trips was not in Disneyland or Six Flags. My dad took us to jungles all over Central and South America, Asia. I've been to church with my dad on the back of horses crossing creeks in El Salvador. I was in Nicaragua with my dad in the middle of a war in the back of a truck with Russian soldiers. Dad, it's a wonder they didn't arrest you for the way you treated me. But I grew up. But here's an amazing thing. I've never been to one mission field where they didn't ask me for something. Which is great. I'm blessed to be blessed. But every time I'm there, I know the shoe's going to drop. Okay, can you buy this? Can you build this? Can you establish this? That's why we got you here. Okay? Until I went to Fiji. So I'm with the village elders and the preachers, and so I asked this question. I said, what do you need? Because I've been there like 5 days, and I'm seeing all this stuff, and I'm not getting any needs. And they got mad. And a Fijian, like warrior, when he's mad, he looks mad. He said, we don't want anything except the word. Yes, sir. And then a little while later, I guess he got to eating on him. And he came back through in this conversation, he said, "We are not poor, but we are hungry." And he said, "We will work. We will find a way." And so this is an amazing thing, that this is going to be a pilot program that we believe we can duplicate in places of the world. It may not be taro or dalos or cucumbers. It may be another thing. But what we're doing is finding these men and women of God are coming together and working. And in order to get this farm going, over 40 people have been coming every week to plant. They planted 10,000 taro tops. And it's just an amazing thing is that they are generating from their own environment a way to expand the gospel in their own nation. This is an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing. We're really, really excited about it. Since we were there in the village of Sigatoka, there was a Trinitarian pastor that began to hear the word of God preached. He was baptized. I think we've got, do we have a picture of him? If not, I can come back to it. Just put up whatever's up there and I'll go off of that. There's Brother Isaiah. That's Pastor Isaiah. He's the lead guy for the farm. Go to the next slide. Okay, this was dinner on the ground. These are the ladies that cooked for the dinner after the service. They hewed those logs. They cut the trees down. They built their entire church by hand. They do everything with a chainsaw. They don't have skill saws. They do everything with a chainsaw. Okay. Next slide. Okay. This is on Sunday afternoon after church, as we were driving back to Nandi to fly home the next morning. We were invited by the second in command of the Ministry of Agriculture for the Fijian Islands. This is Johnny. Johnny was there. He is directing. We are at his farm and his personal residence. He invited us, and he gave us all of the process that we need to establish Bosco International, as well as the Rock Church of Fiji in the Agricultural Department. The Fijian Agricultural Department has stepped up to the plate. They said, "We've had a lot of people come and go, but we have had very little, if any, American investment in the agricultural department." And he said, "I've been to your city." He said, "I came on an agricultural tour of the San Joaquin Valley." And he said, "Now you're at my home." And he said, "The eagle has landed." And he's excited. He said, "In fact, we want to do everything we can to help you." And he said, "We want to see you help the ministers and the people of the highlands and the interior." And there's not this big issue. They're not afraid of us being a church. They're not afraid of faith. In fact, they are embracing faith. And they are excited. Anything that we can do to help the church and the village is there. And we have they want to help us expand to other islands. And they have said, Pastor Young, "We will donate the seeds. And we will be the consultants agronomy on the dirt. We'll tell you what's going to work better in these communities, what's going to work better in those communities. We want to partner with you with the Rock Church of Fiji." I mean, it didn't get any better than that. God has just opened up amazing doors. We were at the home of the second command of the agricultural department of the whole nation. God's opened up a great door. So when you pray for Johnny and the efforts there. Go to the next slide. Am I boring you? Are y'all interested in this? This is cool stuff. This picture is one of the most moving moments of our trip. This was in service on Sunday. And the man in the bright purple shirt is a pastor. This is on Sunday. On Saturday morning, he buried his son. On Saturday afternoon, he performed the wedding of his daughter. And on Sunday afternoon, he was in the altar when we finished preaching. At one point, he got to weeping under the power of the Holy Ghost, and he didn't know how to contain it. So it was like watching Nate Wilson Jr. He started running a little lap around the pulpit. And I looked at Brother Wilson, I said, "That must be one of your disciples right there." But that man had buried a son and married a daughter. And the next day, he was back in church. And he said, "The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away, but I will bless his holy name." That's the kind of people we're working with. That's the kind of people they're just committed to see the work of God go forward. And he and his congregation are heavily invested in making the Bible school effort a reality and to see what God is going to do. Are there any other slides? Do we have any of the videos that are there? Okay, what do we got next? Go to the next one. Okay, we'll see if this works. I'm not
a I greet you from Naitofini, Fiji, where we are standing on what is going to be the home of Bosco Farms. Well, it's already presently going. The farm has been planted. The first harvest will be 9 months from now. This is also going to be over to my left, and your right is going to be the home of the university, Wilson University, expanding into the South Pacific, where we will be training leaders from the South Pacific right here out of Fiji. And this whole area is being developed. Behind me, you can see electric lines that came in after we made the decision to come here. Into the hillside, the property goes all the way up over this mountain. We are at somewhere around between 2,500 and 3,000 feet in elevation, which is perfect for growing coffee. Our dream is to plant coffee up under this shade-grown area, right here from Fiji. The idea is that from this farm, it will produce the income that we'll be able to take the profits of the produce that is raised here to build a Bible school, expand the churches, and plant churches throughout the South Pacific. So this is ground zero of productivity and revival moving forward for the Rock Church of Fiji.
In Fiji, out here is part of the upper part of the property from where we'll be working and building. Each one of these plugs, these taro plants, go in and they reproduce, and they produce up to five other tops. And then you split them up and you can replant them. And so here is a sustainable model of missions that doesn't take outside sourcing, but it's organically grown within to support both the people and the mission. So this is an incredible opportunity for us to take hold of and do farming in a companionship effort with those that are in the church. This is awesome for us, and it's awesome for them, because what it does is it opens up potential to turn all of the Southeast Pacific into a staging area for the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank God for this opportunity. We're looking forward to great things.
Okay. Is that it? Now, here's what developed. Brother, as you know, Brother Walker, who preaches here many times, one of our favorite guys around here, pastors in Yucaipa, and God has just opened incredible doors, not only for them locally, but most of you know, for many years, he's been working in and out of the Philippines, and primarily island of Palawan, and God has used him. He's helped start businesses with people there to help. He's one of these guys. One of the reasons I brought him with us is we're trying to approach missions from a different standpoint. Instead of just giving a handout, let's give a hand up. Let's find a way to work together and network. Let's do what we can do, and they do what we can do, and let's move forward. So he's one of the people I chose to go with us. And in Palawan, one of the things that they have wanted to do with the Filipino brethren and those that are and sisters that are wanting to be involved in ministry is train them. But in trying to bring them to the United States, they have run into great difficulty in being able to get the Filipino ministers into a place of education where they can come learn. They can't get into America. It's very difficult for them, and they've tried. It's one of the big things they have wrestled with in Palawan. But what we discovered, he went to work, he met with the consulate, he met with the Philippine government, and he discovered that they can go to Fiji. It's about a 90-minute process of paperwork, and those ministers can be trained in Fiji. One of the things for the South Pacific that is unique, there are two big universities in Fiji. There's Fiji International University, and then there's the University of the South Pacific. These are two big universities. And the reason is because of the way the islands are,
There are students from all over the South Pacific and Asia that go there because you do not have to have a visa to go to school in Fiji. And so as a result, those universities are growing, expanding, because people from all over the South Pacific, New Zealand, and Australia are traveling to Fiji to go to school. So now, when you drop Dr. Wilson into a place like that, and his brain starts working, and you got an open door for university, and then when we began to talk, we found out, we see that Fiji and Wilson University Extension in the islands of Fiji could become literally the epicenter of training ministers throughout Asia and the South Pacific that could never get to America. But through the online model of Wilson University, we can sit right here and offer education into a training environment, and God has just opened up incredible doors. It's blowing our mind. We didn't plan all this. It just kind of just went boom. If you're faithful over a few things, I'll make you ruler over many. Amen. So these are some of the things that we're wrapping up the year we wanted you to know about. When you pray over the holidays, pray for the Shrekises. Pray for the Joneses. Pray for Honduras and Roa 10. Pray for what God's doing in Rome and Italy and beyond. And pray for what God's doing in Fiji. These are just some of the things that God is doing because of your faithfulness right here locally. This is not an average church. We're not an average people. We have a non-average call upon our life. And as we're faithful here locally, God is opening up doors that are going to blow our mind. Who knows what it's going to look like in 10 years in Roa 10? What's it going to look like in the mainland in the next 10 years of Honduras? What's it going to look like in Rome in 10 years? What's it going to look like in Fiji and the South Pacific and Palawan and wherever else God's doing? This is an amazing journey we're on. And so as you go into holidays, just know one thing. You need to feel good about what you're doing. Because every time, whether it's $5 or it's $500 or it's $1,000, when you give to missions in this church, you are literally impacting the world. And people are going to spend eternity in God's mercy and love because you gave and you prayed and you taught a Bible study. God's doing some great things in our community of faith. Would you stand with me? I want us to end this way. This is our last midweek service of 2017. We're going to hit the year with a bang. We're going to have revival unprecedented next year. We're just seeing God do great things. But I think we ought to just end this year of midweek services by just thanking God. We've been through some storms. Some of you may be in a storm right now, but you're still here. And God's added to the church. Not only locally, but globally, and we're a part of what God is doing as participants in the Missio Dei, the mission of God. He's working through us. Grab somebody's hand and lift your voice strong, and let's end this year with thanksgiving. Come on, lift your voice. Let your neighbor hear you pray. God, you have been so good to us. You have gifted us, you have blessed us, you've given us talented singers, you've given us anointed ministry, you bring the greatest preachers through to preach to us again and again, God. You've gifted teachers to teach Sunday school and people with passion and burdens, and we've got jobs and roofs over our head, God. We have so much to be thankful for, but we're also thankful that you have allowed us to be a part of a revival community, a revival church that is touching not only our city, but touching the world. We count it a privilege and an honor to be a part of what you're doing in the earth in this year. I pray blessing upon Brother and Sister Jones, upon Brother and Sister Shrekais, God, upon what you're doing in the Philippines, and what you're doing with the Platanias, and what you're doing in other things that we'll be talking about as the years go by. I thank you today that we have an opportunity together as believers to make an impact in this world for your gospel. Everybody say, thank you, Jesus. Amen. Well, I love you. Merry Christmas, everybody. Amen. Wash your hands every chance you get. Don't spread the flu around. Now, Sister Young's not here tonight because she has dengue fever. She was in Jamaica. As you know, she is working not only with what we're doing here, she's working and leading the philanthropic effort for a large investment firm. She had to fly to Jamaica to meet with the Minister of Agriculture there. We got a whole farm system developing there. And all of this is connected to missions. And while she was there, she was bitten by mosquitoes. And evidently one of them or some of them had dengue virus. And the first 7 days were very rough. Some of y'all didn't know it. She was singing Sunday night. She's not contagious, but it's been very, very bad. Extreme headaches and fever. Had 105, 106 fever. And but she's on the downside of it. She's getting better. Just pray for her that God will give her a speedy recovery. And we'll see you Sunday morning. Merry Christmas. Hug a neck, shake a hand. God bless you.